Let us worship God and sing to his praise from Psalm 145. A correction from what is printed in the bulletin. We'll be singing verses 8 to 14. So we're singing again from the second version, Psalm 145, beginning at verse 8 and singing through verse 14. The tune is Doversdale, which is tune number 4. The psalm opens by praising God as a great king, but it proceeds to speak about the tenderness of his reign. The Lord our God is gracious, compassionate is he also. In mercy he is plenteous, but unto wrath and anger slow. And then notice in verses 9 and 10, good unto all men is the Lord, o'er all his works his mercy is. Thy works all praise to thee afford, thy saints, O Lord, thy name shall bless. Verses 8 to 14. Stand and seek the Lord in prayer. O Lord, our Lord, how excellent is thy name in all the earth. We confess that you are the great benefactor from which all blessings flow to us. We, Lord, come acknowledging that all things are from you, and all glory goes to you. We have our sustenance, our existence, yea, our very happiness, it is all found in you. We confess that left to ourselves, we would have a native inability to see any of these things. It would all be unseen as to blind men, and our pride would deny it and resist it. We confess that your Spirit comes to work grace in the souls of your people, rescues us from the mire, the miry pit of clay, in order to give us life. We thank you, O Lord, for the fact that the Lord Jesus Christ has been sent forth, that he is the great physician, that by his stripes we are healed, that he is the one who is able to bind the brokenhearted, to heal the pierced soul, who is able to come in and among those who have sought to destroy themselves and to speak words of life and grace. We pray that you would fill our eyes with his majesty, and that you, O Lord, would be pleased to do us good, to enable us to remember with whom we have to do this afternoon. That you would be pleased, O Lord, to lift up our hearts in adoration of your great name. We come, O Lord, thanking you for your eternal Son, who did not despise us in our misery, but who came to bear our griefs and our sorrows, and in pity to remember us, and to seek to bring and to secure a salvation for your people. Though he was rich, yet he became poor, that we through his poverty might be made rich. And we ask, O God, that you would again look with tenderness upon us, if your goodness is displayed to all men, as we have just sung, then how much more the preciousness of your saving grace to your own people. O Lord, it encourages us and aids us and fuels us in the work of repentance to not set our faces away from you, but to turn to you with hope of the great mercy that is to be found in Christ Jesus. And so we pray, receive us freely for Christ's sake. Cleanse and forgive us, O Lord, for our many sins. And grant that your word of promise would be esteemed in our hearts, that we would be able to say with that one of old, thy words were found, and we did eat them, and they were the joy and rejoicing of our hearts. To say with Jeremiah, is not thy word as a fire and like a hammer that breaketh the rock in pieces? O Lord, grant that this word may have free course and be glorified among us, that you would send it forth as light and truth to conquer our hearts and to subdue us unto yourself. We pray that you would bless us in all of our neediness, that we would be able to delight in you and to have overflowing joy. Christ has spoken to us in order that our joy might be full. May we know the joy that is found in lowliness, the joy that is found in clinging to the Redeemer, the joy of being able to say that this beloved is ours and that we are his, to be bound by way of covenant and marriage to our heavenly husband, to be received and taken into union with him. We thank you, O Lord, for these blessings. And if you have not spared your own Son, how much more will you not freely also give us all things in him? And so help us in our temporal needs. We are creatures. We have bodies. We have temporal concerns that weigh us down. Oh Lord, you know the complexities of our circumstances. Our Savior himself has tenderness and compassion toward us, having been subjected to these. We pray that you would be pleased, O Lord, to provide to each their portion in their season, that you would impart health where that is needed, that you would impart wisdom for decisions, that you would repair the breach of broken relationships. We pray, O Lord, that you would be pleased to come to us in the things we can see, that you, the unseen and eternal God, would undertake to provide and bless your people. We ask, O God, that as you have taught us, that we should bring all of our cares unto you. And yet we are conscious that our cares are few in comparison to the cares of many. And we pray for those who are persecuted. We pray, O Lord, for those in prison. We desire to remember them as if bound with them. And we ask that you would be looking with a tender eye upon your afflicted people who, for the sake of Christ and the testimony of the gospel and of faithfulness to you, have lost loved ones, who have lost their living, who have lost some of them in threat of losing their lives. We pray that you would preserve and protect, that you would provide for them in their extremities, that they would find that you are faithful, that though they are cast into the burning furnace heated seven times, that there is one like the Son of Man with them. We pray that you would send, O Lord, help and the Spirit of grace to give them a faithful testimony. Those who love not their lives unto death, but who testify to the glory of Christ. We pray that you would bless as well our own circumstances as a nation. We look, O Lord, into the face of another election. We are humbled to see where we are as a nation. Our spirits are grieved. We can say at times with the psalmist that tears run down our eyes when we see how they break your law. To see those bent on the destruction of themselves and on the destruction of our country, we can only come to you, the King of Heaven, and to confess, praise be to your name, there is another King, whose name is Jesus, who is the King of kings, who rules over all the affairs of men, who looks upon nations as less than dust in the balance. Our hope is to be found in your reign, in your kingdom. Grant to us, O Lord, the ability to day by day pledge our allegiance to Christ and his crown rights. We pray that you would help us to humble ourselves. Lord, we deserve far more judgment than we have received. Your glory is worthy of being vindicated. Your name is to be honored above all else. We pray that you would indeed teach princes that they are mere men, that though they claim the powers of deity, that they will die like dogs and be laid in the dust, and their names and memories will be left as merely that. We pray that you, O Lord, would teach princes, kings, and judges to serve the Lord with fear and to rejoice with trembling, to kiss the Son lest they perish in the way. And give us, O Lord, a quiet confidence and security that is to be found in you. We pray, O Lord, for the cause of Zion, how we long to see her revived, to see recovered all that you have committed to her. We, like Nehemiah, hear of the and see the walls of Zion crumbled and overgrown and laid in the dirt. And we, like him, have our hearts go out to you with sorrow and prayer, asking, would you, O Lord, not undertake to do us good, to rend the heavens and to come down, to bring the repentance so desperately needed, to humble us, that we might, under these sore trials and afflictions, be brought to our senses and to return to you and your word. We have long cried for such, in secret and in public, asking, O Lord, that you would turn us again, and that the light of your countenance would be raised up upon us, knowing that then we will be safe. We pray that you would hear our cry, how long, O Lord, until you will come and revive your cause. And so our eyes are fixed upon you. As a maid looks to the hand of her mistress, so our eyes look longingly, O Lord, to you, praying that you would yet hear us and that you would answer according to your own ability and power. Help us in our daily walk. Give us watchfulness that we might watch and pray, vigilantly keeping our hearts out of which flow the issues of life. Grant, Lord, that we would keep short accounts with you, that we would be quick to repent. Grant that we would cultivate and nurture that sweet fellowship and communion with you that is to be sustained day by day, praying without ceasing. Help us to be a people that meditate upon your law day and night, to be a people who are conscious of your presence, whose goal and aim and desire and longing and dream is to bring you glory. Bless us as a congregation to that end. Deliver us, O Lord, from every snare of the devil. Protect us from the assaults from without and within. We pray that you would be lifting up a shield to defend us, that you would give wisdom and discernment to parents and spouses and siblings, that we would know, O Lord, your upholding to walk with in the pursuit of holiness. Bless us in our worship. You have given this to us, the worship of God on the Sabbath day. And this, O Lord, is the pivotal force that you have provided for the framing of the piety of your people. Do we cherish it? Please do not take it away from us, and please do not allow our wandering hearts to turn from it, but rather, O Lord, enable us to with diligence seek your face while you may be found. Come to us yet again this afternoon and speak your word into our hearts and lives. Grant us help to enter into this worship and our singing and reading and prayer with a full heart and with expectation. We ask it in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. Let's sing together from Psalm 81, verses 8 to 11. The tune is St. Flavian, which is tune number 112. Psalm 81, verses 8 to 11. In verse 8, it speaks about us hearing. In verse 9, about us doing. And in verse 10, about us opening our mouths wide with the assured promise that God would fill them. So let's sing together Psalm 81, verses 8 to 11, to tune 112.
Thank you.
Let us worship God in the reading of his word as it is found in 1 Kings chapter 13. 1 Kings chapter 13. And behold, there came a man of God, thus saith the Lord. Behold, the child shall be born unto the house of David, Josiah by name. And upon thee shall he offer the priests of the high places that burn incense upon thee, and men's bones shall be burnt upon thee. And he gave a sign the same day, saying, This is the sign which the Lord hath spoken. Behold, the altar shall be rent, and the ashes that are upon it shall be poured out. And it came to pass, when King Jeroboam heard the saying of the man of God, which had cried against the altar in Bethel, that he put forth his hand from the altar, saying, Lay hold on him. And his hand, which he put forth against him, dried up, so that he could not pull it in again to him. The altar also was rent, and the ashes poured out from the altar, according to the sign which the man of God had given by the word of the Lord. And the king answered and said unto the man of God, Entreat now the face of the Lord thy God, and pray for me, that my hand may be restored me again. The man of God besought the Lord. The king's hand was restored him again, and became as it was before. And the king said unto the man of God, Come home with me, and refresh thyself, and I will give thee a reward. And the man of God said unto the king, If thou wilt give me half thine house, I will not go in with thee, neither will I eat bread nor drink water in this place. For so was it charged me by the word of the Lord, saying, Eat no bread nor drink water, nor turn again by the same way that thou camest. So he went another way and returned not by the way that he came to Bethel. Now there dwelt an old prophet in Bethel, and his sons came and told him all the works that the man of God had done that day in Bethel. The words which he had spoken unto the king, them they told also to their father. And their father said unto them, What way went he? For his sons had seen what way the man of God went, which came from Judah. And he said unto his sons, Saddle me the ass. So they saddled him the ass, and he rode thereon, and went after the man of God, and found him sitting under an oak. And he said unto him, Art thou the man of God that camest from Judah? And he said, I am. Then he said unto him, Come home with me, and eat bread. And he said, I may not return with thee, nor go in with thee, neither will I eat bread nor drink water with thee in this place. For it was said to me by the word of the Lord, Thou shalt eat no bread, nor drink water there, nor turn again to go by the way that thou camest. And he said unto him, I am a prophet also, as thou art. And an angel spake unto me by the word of the Lord, saying, Bring him back with thee into thine house, that he may eat bread and drink water. But he lied unto him. So he went back with him, and did eat bread in his house, and drank water. And it came to pass, as they sat at the table, that the word of the Lord came unto the prophet that brought him back. And he cried unto the man of God that came from Judah, saying, Thus saith the Lord, Forasmuch as thou hast disobeyed the mouth of the Lord, and hast not kept the commandment which the Lord thy God commanded thee, but camest back, and hast eaten bread, and drunk water in the place, of the which the Lord did say to thee, Eat no bread, and drink no water, thy carcass shall not come unto the sepulchre of thy fathers. It came to pass, after he had eaten bread, and after he had drunk, that he saddled for him the ass, to wit, for the prophet whom he had brought back. And when he was gone, a lion met him by the way, and slew him. And his carcass was cast in the way, and the ass stood by it, the lion also stood by the carcass. Behold, men passed by, and saw the carcass cast in the way, and the lion standing by the carcass. And they came and told it in the city where the old prophet dwelt. When the prophet that brought him back from the way heard thereof, he said, It is the man of God who is disobedient unto the word of the Lord. Therefore the Lord hath delivered him unto the lion, which hath torn him and slain him, according to the word of the Lord, which he spake unto him. And he spake to his sons, saying, Saddle me the ass. And they saddled him. And he went and found his carcass cast in the way, and the ass and the lion standing by the carcass. The lion had not eaten the carcass, nor torn the ass. And the prophet took up the carcass of the man of God, and laid it upon the ass, and brought it back. And the old prophet came to the city to mourn and to bury him. And he laid his carcass in his own grave, and they mourned over him, saying, Alas, my brother! It came to pass after he had buried him that he spake to his son, saying, When I am dead, then bury me in the sepulchre wherein the man of God is buried. Lay my bones beside his bones. For the saying which he cried by the word of the Lord against the altar in Bethel and against all the houses of the high places which are in the cities of Samaria shall surely come to pass. After this thing, Jeroboam returned not from his evil way, but made again of the lowest of the people priests of the high places. Whosoever would, he consecrated him. He became one of the priests of the high places. And this thing became a sin unto the house of Jeroboam, even to cut it off and to destroy it from off the face of the earth. May the Lord bless this reading of his holy word. Let's continue to worship the Lord by lifting our hearts up to him in praise. We'll sing the remainder of Psalm 81, verses 12 to 16, and the tune is Saint Anne, which is tune number 106. Tune 106, Psalm 81, verses 12 to 16. The words which we concluded with just a moment ago in verse 11 are chilling. But yet my people to my voice would not attentive be. That's bad, but what follows is worse. And even my chosen Israel, he would have none of me. The people of God saying, we won't have the Lord, turning a deaf ear to him. Well, it goes on, so to the lusts of their own hearts I them delivered. And then in counsels of their own they vainly wandered. These are sobering words, words that recount the history of our fathers and words of warning to everyone who takes them up into their mouth. Let's sing together these verses.
Oh,
Our New Testament reading is found in 2 Timothy chapter 2. Second Timothy 2, beginning at verse 1. Thou therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. And the things that thou hast heard of me among many witnesses, the same commit thou to faithful men, who shall be able to teach others also. Thou therefore endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. No man that warreth entangleth himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him who hath chosen him to be a soldier. And if a man also strive for masteries, yet is he not crowned, except he strive lawfully. The husbandman that laboreth must be first partaker of the fruits. Consider what I say, and the Lord give thee understanding in all things. Remember that Jesus Christ of the seed of David was raised from the dead according to my gospel, wherein I suffer trouble as an evildoer, even unto bonds. But the word of God is not bound. Therefore I endure all things for the elect's sakes, that they may also obtain the salvation which is in Christ Jesus with eternal glory. It is a faithful saying, for if we be dead with him, we shall also live with him. If we suffer, we shall also reign with him. If we deny him, he also will deny us. If we believe not, yet he abideth faithful. He cannot deny himself. Of these things put them in remembrance, charging them before the Lord that they strive not about words to no profit, but to the subverting of the hearers. Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. But shun profane and vain babblings, for they will increase unto more ungodliness, and their word will eat as doth a canker, of whom is Hymenaeus and Philetus, who concerning the truth have erred, saying that the resurrection is past already, and overthrow the faith of some. Nevertheless, the foundation of God standeth sure, having this seal, the Lord knoweth them that are his. And let every one that nameth the name of Christ depart from iniquity. But in a great house there are not only vessels of gold and of silver, but also of wood and of earth, and some to honor and some to dishonor. If a man therefore purge himself from these, he shall be a vessel unto honor, sanctified and meet for the master's use, and prepared unto every good work. Flee also youthful lusts, but follow righteousness, faith, charity, peace, with them that can call on the Lord out of a pure heart. But foolish and unlearned questions avoid, knowing that they do gender strifes. And the servant of the Lord must not strive, but be gentle unto all men, apt to teach, patient, in meekness, instructing those that oppose themselves. If God peradventure will give them repentance to the acknowledging of the truth, and that they may recover themselves out of the snare of the devil, who are taken captive by him at his will. Amen. We return this afternoon to our study of 1 Kings, and we come to chapter 13. Where we'll be considering together verses 1 to 10. So 1 Kings chapter 13, our text is found in those first 10 verses. The chapter opens with these words, "And behold, there came a man of God out of Judah by the word of the Lord unto Bethel, and Jeroboam stood by the altar to burn incense." The Bible tells us over and over again, and the history of the world testifies, that all false gods fail. every last one of them. Always. All false gods fail. If you make them, God will break them. That is guaranteed. If you make them, God will break them, because God's greatest concern is his own glory. And God will introduce all sorts of discomfort into people's lives in order to secure his own glory. Here we are hearing the unfolding of the story of Jeroboam. You need to realize, of course, that our chapter divisions, while helpful, don't reflect the original text itself. So remember that chapter 12 is flowing immediately into chapter 13. It's continuing. You know, the thought is being carried forward into chapter 13. I want us to note three things as we work our way through these 10 verses. The first is receiving God's word. So this is verses 1 to 3. First of all, receiving God's word. Here we have a description of Jeroboam, and we find him standing at the altar. Now, this is, as you know, not the altar that is appointed by God in Jerusalem, wherein Israel was to bring their sacrifices at the feast that God had designated for them. He's standing before the altar of a false god, one that he, out of his own imagination, had erected, associated with the golden calves which he had created in Bethel and Dan. Having put everything in place, now he's there. And so he's standing at the altar. So you should imagine that the atmosphere in verse 1 carries with it the sanctity of worship. A worship service is taking place here. People are assembled. Sacrifices are being offered. There's already burnt ashes in the altar. You should also be mindful of the fact that this is not some camping cook stove that you have when you go tenting. I mean, this is a substantial structure built of big stones which could hold the volume and weight of several whole beasts that would be offered in sacrifice. So that's where we are. We're in Bethel before this altar, and there's a man, perhaps imperceptibly at first, but he comes into the crowd and slips through the people to the front at the altar itself and intrudes, in fact, interrupts these acts of worship that are taking place. And the passage says that he cried out against the altar. So here we hear him lifting up his voice, and there is this tirade that spews forth against the altar, crying out against it, saying directly to it, "O altar, altar, thus saith the Lord," or "thus saith Jehovah." And then he goes on to say that God is going to raise up a king in Judah, right? Jeroboam's in the northern tribes. These are the northern kingdom. He says God's going to raise up in the southern kingdom, in Judah, another king. And his name's going to be Josiah. And when he comes to be king, he's going to come back to Bethel, and he's going to kill all of your priests. And then he's going to pollute and desecrate your altar by burning their human bones on top of it. And he's going to tear it down and destroy it. Well, you can imagine how this would be received, right? This is something that they have erected, something they've owned, something that they feel very much emotionally attached to. But the prophet does more. He says, "And a sign will accompany God's word." So God's word's been proclaimed, and here's a sign that will testify to it and confirm it. The altar that you're standing in front of is going to be ripped in half, and the ashes are going to be dumped out upon the ground. Now the word here where it says rent, remember a chapter or two ago, when Ahijah comes to Jeroboam, he takes his new garment and rips it, right? Tears it into 12 pieces. It's the same root word that's being used here. And so this big structure, this weighty altar, he says, the Lord's going to tear it like a cloth. It's going to be torn wide open, and all of the ashes are going to drop out of it, dump out of it. Now, at first pass, we're inclined to think, you know, this looks like mayhem. I mean, we have these religious rituals which are taking place. This prophet comes into the middle, disrupts the entire thing, and makes this very sober, chilling declaration against not only the altar, but the priests, not only against them, but Jeroboam and the nation as a whole. But my friends, though it may seem like mayhem, it's mercy. There's mercy all through these first 10 verses. There is mercy here. Jeroboam thinks all is going well. He's got the kingdom now. He's come up with his new civil policy where they're going to have their own calves to worship, their own priests that he's appointed, their own rituals, their own feast days. Everything's going well. It appears as if they're successful. It appears as if they're strong. Rehoboam is turned back. He hasn't come to try to attack them. For all they, as far as they're concerned, God's on their side. God's blessing them. All's going well for them. Until God comes and breaks in to their world. God comes and disrupts their comforts. And the word of God shatters to pieces this pagan, idolatrous ritual and liturgy. The Lord shatters it. There's something sudden about what happens here. There's something severe, even, about what happens here. But it is a mercy, I say. God is coming with his word to confront gross sin. And whenever God does that, he is giving to someone more than they deserve. One of the worst forms of God's judgment is for him to withdraw his word. If God stops speaking to a people, if God takes away his word from a people, then the story's over at that point. But God is not silent. God is speaking into this situation. It is a word of warning that has come. If Jeroboam had been left with no restrictions, if Jeroboam had been left to do as he pleased, if Jeroboam had not been hemmed in at all, it would have been travesty. But instead, the Lord comes to him and speaks a word of warning. And the reason is because although Jeroboam has thus far rejected Scripture, he is still bound to it. Remember the words we read from the New Testament in 2 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 9, when I suffer trouble as an evildoer, even unto bonds, but the word of God is not bound. Rejecting the Bible gets you nowhere. You've accomplished no thing. In order to reject God's word does not somehow loose you from being bound to that word, not by a long shot. And so here is Jeroboam. Now, what's interesting is this heavy word comes to Jeroboam. The word of God is being brought to him, and it's a word of judgment. Why doesn't Jeroboam turn around and appeal to the golden calves? You know, why doesn't he say, hey, say what you want. We have our own idols here, and we've got our own system that we've come up with. Why doesn't he turn to them and appeal to them? Well, because Jeroboam knows, doesn't he? He knows that those gods, as he's called them, are worthless. They are mere products of man's craftsmanship. They can't hear his cry. They can't see his dilemma. And they have no ability to move or the power to deliver him. They can do nothing for him. False gods always fail. All idols, all kinds of idols, fail always. And so Here he is with receiving God's word. Secondly, we see him rejecting God's word, verses 4 and 5. Rejecting God's word. And it came to pass when King Jeroboam heard the saying of the man of God, which had cried against the altar in Bethel, that he put forth his hand from the altar, saying, "Lay hold on him." And his hand, which he put forth against him, dried up so that he could not pull it in again to him. The altar also was rent, and the ashes poured out from the altar according to the sign which the man of God had given by the word of the Lord. So here's Jeroboam. He's a king now, right? He's a king of 10 tribes, and that means he's got power. That means he's the boss. He's got control, and he's going to show that control. You know, some renegade southern prophet comes barging into our territory and blasting all of these things with his mouth and so on. And so what does he do? He lifts his index finger and stretches out his arm and says, in essence, "Seize him. We will shut him up and shut him down." In other words, lay hold on him, the passage says. And what does it tell us, children? His face goes from beet red, he's mad, to white. All of the sudden, he is clothed with fear and confusion. And he discovers that his outstretched hand is frozen. He can't withdraw it. He can't pull his hand back in. The Lord had brought about some form of paralysis or something. And so there it is. He can't pull his hand back. And what's more, his own eyes watch as his hand withers before his eyes and the eyes of everyone else that is looking on. And simultaneous to all of that, this altar splits wide open and the ashes all come pouring out upon the ground. All of this suddenly. Again, we're seeing here something of a severe mercy. What's God doing? Well, the first thing we think of is God is protecting his servant, and there's mercy in that, and it's true. You know, the Lord has sent that man. He's God's mouthpiece. And so if Jeroboam's going to rise up against him, then Jeroboam's going to be, you know, struck down as a result. The Lord's delivering his servant. But it's not just that. The Lord is also restraining Jeroboam from further sin. If he were to take God's man and kill him, imprison him, or whatever else he would do, he would be heaping up sin upon sin. For the Lord to freeze him, his arm midair, and wither his hand, and to prevent him from this move is itself a severe mercy. This is not how the Lord's people think at times. The Lord's people at times drift into sin. And there are thoughts they're entertaining, there are words they're speaking, there are actions, there are priorities, there are affections that they're allowing to go unchecked, and there are steps that are happening where they're going into sin. And the Lord comes and he will break into your life and he will turn you upside down in a heartbeat. And the Lord's people at times fail to trace the mercy in that. If the Lord shuts you down and prevents you from further sin, that, my friends, is a token of mercy. It's as if the Lord comes to Jeroboam and says, "Keep this up, Jeroboam. If you keep this up, how many limbs do you want to keep?" He's restraining him. Well, we have a clear word from God, and we have a confirmed word from God, and a word of mercy at that. It's a call. It's a call to come to his spiritual senses, if you will. And what you see is two things side by side. There are short-term prophecies that are being confirmed. He just said, altar's going to be ripped open, rent, and the ashes are going to be poured out. But he also said some other things, like in the future, there's someone that's going to be born that hasn't been born yet. His name's going to be Josiah. He's going to kill all these priests. And he's going to burn their bones on this altar, and he's going to trash it. He's going to destroy the altar. Well, the short-term prophecies being confirmed show that the long-term prophecies will also be confirmed. In other words, Jeroboam has some additional benefit in this sense. God has spoken his word and he's given a sign. He's confirmed his word and confirmed the sign. That means if Jeroboam has any sense at all, if this has happened, then the rest of the stuff that he said is also going to happen. And therefore, I better take heed to what's being spoken to me. Right down to the very details, these prophecies are being confirmed. Now, this is an aside, in a sense, but it comes to us as well. We can open our Bibles, and we see dozens and dozens and dozens of prophecies which the Lord predicted. He gave his word sometimes dozens of years, sometimes hundreds of years before their fulfillment. And we're able to look on both sides. We can see when they were given, and then we can see them confirmed, them being fulfilled. We see the prophecies actually coming to pass within the scriptures itself. That ought to, for the Christian, strengthen, deepen, deeply root their faith. Because if we've seen all of these things that the Lord's prophesied already that's been fulfilled, then we know all that he's prophesied that is yet to be fulfilled will also be confirmed. We can be sure, down to the details, that it will be so. And so the Lord tears this altar, and it's a word to Jeroboam. I've torn your altar, and I will tear your kingdom as well. Right? It's a sign of God's power, fact that he accomplishes this. It's a sign of God's truth, that what he says, in fact, happens. It's also a sign of his grace. Because here, Jeroboam is given an opportunity to obey. The reproof that comes from the prophet should lead to repentance. The Lord warns him and reproves him in order to drive him to repentance. That would be the right response, would be to say, this is a wake-up call. My bell has been rung. The Lord Jehovah has my attention, and now I'm going to meekly, humbly submit to him and repent of my sins. He's being challenged by Scripture. But that's not what happens. He rejects the word of the Lord. He tries to stop it. God's word comes, and he says, stop the man from speaking. Stop him. He's angry ultimately with Jehovah himself. And so he grabs the closest thing to him, and that is God's man. Now, my friends, this has more relevance to us than many of us would like to think. The Lord comes to us regularly challenging us with the scripture. You're reading in family worship, you're reading in your private worship, and especially in the preaching of God's word, God comes to you and he challenges you. And the Lord is saying, all is not well. And the Lord is putting his finger on your conscience and he's exposing sin and he's showing you at times heart idolatries. And the Lord is warning you through the ministry of his word. He's warning you. And the temptation can be, as we see with Jeroboam, the temptation can be to somehow try to stop what God is saying. Right? There's an irritation sometimes under when the Lord is confronting and addressing, the Lord is breaking in and disrupting our comforts, all seems to be going well, and the Lord bursts onto the scene, and in the preaching of his word says, not so fast. There's a temptation to chafe under that. And there are various ways of trying to stop it, right? One is to try to stop it by force. That's what we see with Jeroboam. The other is to try to stop it by fleeing. That's what we see with Jonah. Right, people can say, I'm going to run away from what God is saying. Or they can say, I'm going to do everything in my power to stop what it is that God's saying. But the fact is, God is greater than all of his enemies. He's greater than all opposition. He's greater than any resistance anyone can muster. The fact is that there is no resisting his word. It is invincible in might and power. And that means there's only one real option, and that is to come under his word and to repent and to submit ourselves with meekness to him. If the Lord comes and says, if the Lord is exposing idols in your life, the Lord is coming and breaking in and saying, here are latent, quiet, hidden idolatries in your life. The last thing in the world you should do is cling to those idols. False gods always fail. Always. It is foolishness to cling to those idols. And it can be people that you've made idols of. And it can be work, and it can be possessions, and it can be position and power and all sorts of other things. Men make idols out of stones and fallen trees. Right? It's showing the insanity of sin. How much more are we able to make idols out of all sorts of other things? Our hobbies and recreations and interests and spouses and friends and you name it. There's all sorts of things that people can make idols of. The Lord is saying, false gods always fail. And yet here Jeroboam is rejecting God's word. Thirdly, reconsidering God's word. Verses 6 to 10. And the king answered and said unto the man of God, entreat now the face of the Lord thy God, and pray for me, that my hand may be restored me again. And the man of God besought the Lord, and the king's hand was restored him again, and it became as it was before. Reconsidering God's word. Under this chastening, Jeroboam decides to change his approach. He says, I have to shift my game plan here. After all, paralysis gets the attention even of kings. Even kings sit up and pay attention to paralysis. So Jeroboam's a fast learner. He realizes this is not going to work. And so he turns, does an about face, and he pleads with the man in verse 6. But notice the pronoun. It's very, very insightful, very important. Entreat now the face of the Lord thy God. Jeroboam doesn't say, entreat now the face of the Lord our God, Jehovah our God, but rather thy God. Jeroboam's heart has departed from the Lord. Jeroboam, his feet have departed from the Lord. Jeroboam is alienated from the Lord. Well, the man of God prays for him and his hand is restored. And the king apparently is mollified because he goes from arresting the prophet to rewarding the prophet. Notice the diplomacy. And the king said unto the man of God, come home with me and refresh thyself, and I will give thee a reward. Come home for lunch with me, and I'm going to be nice to you and give you gifts and so on and so forth. What does the prophet say? The man of God said unto the king, if thou wilt give me half thine house, I will not go in with thee, neither will I eat bread nor drink water in this place. In other words, the prophet says politely but very matter-of-factly, I am not for sale. I am not for sale. I don't belong to you. I don't belong to myself. I belong to Jehovah. I have a word from heaven, and it doesn't matter what you give me, Jeroboam. I'm following what God has said. So the prophet rejects the offer. He says, in essence, what's happening here? He's saying, there is no socializing with apostates. So I'm not going to be associating with an apostate, right? It's an expression of excommunication. I'm not going to sit down and hang out with you as if all is well. The Lord has come to Jeroboam and he's shown Jeroboam in his hand what he could do to his whole kingdom. I can wither it, and I can restore it. He's showing Jeroboam. And it's as if the Lord is saying to Jeroboam, do you not see what I can do for you? Jeroboam, if you would repent of your flagrant sin, you have corrupted the worship of God, you have created all sorts of idols. If you would repent of this, remember the promise I gave you at the beginning. If you will walk in the paths of David, you will have the blessing of David, and I will make a great nation of you. And here you've immediately run off into this flagrant disregard of my law. Return, Jeroboam. I can restore your withered hand. I can restore your kingdom. But that's not what Jeroboam does. Jeroboam turns to manipulation and repudiation. He's manipulating the prophet. I'll buy you off and get good things from you. And then he ends up repudiating everything. Why? Jeroboam is interested in relief, not repentance. So the Lord comes with chastening. The Lord chastens his people, and there are times when the sole motivation is relief. What's going to take the pressure out of this pressure keg? What is going to deliver me from the stress? What's going to somehow spring me out of the complications that have come as consequences of my sin? That, my friends, is a danger. It's relief that's wanted, not repentance that's wanted. Well, so it is with Jeroboam. There's no God-centered, God-conscious anything on his horizon. In fact, we read later, he repairs the altar that God himself ripped in half. You see at the end of the chapter, he goes back and gets all these worthless, good-for-nothing people and recruits them into the priesthood. Jeroboam goes on promoting his unbiblical, corrupt worship, clinging to his false idols. He forsook his mercies. This is a terrible thing. You know, I've often said in open-air preaching, when I'm preaching, I'll say, you woke up this morning, and you had plans to go to work, you had plans to go to lunch, you had plans to do this, that, and the other thing. You had no plan to go to church. You didn't wake up this morning saying, I'm going to go seek God, I'm going to go hear the gospel, I want to go, you know, deal with my soul, I want to go seek these things out. Didn't even cross your mind. And here is God, and he showed up, and he's broken into your world, and here you are walking down the street, and the Lord is bringing the gospel to you when you haven't sought it. You don't deserve to hear the gospel. God's giving you the gospel, and that's a mercy. Don't forsake your mercies. But this is what happens. Jeroboam, despite all that the Lord has done in this passage, Jeroboam despises God's word. He forsakes the mercies that have been showed to him, which he didn't deserve. And in the process, he heaps up damnation. He heaps up damnation on himself. When there are those who pursue unbiblical, corrupt worship, and God restrains them, is that not a mercy that ought to be heeded? When there are personal idolatries in your life, that you're clinging to with your heart, though perhaps not with your hand, God will barge in suddenly and perhaps severely into your idolatries, and he'll throw up roadblocks that you will never get over the top of. And he'll send sometimes ministers with his word to confront it. But my friends, what is the Lord doing? He is seeking to pry loose your fingers from your golden calves. That's a blessing. To deliver you from your golden calves. Beware, beware, beware of crashing through the divine roadblocks that God puts up in front of us. False gods always fail. We see it all the time. There's roadblocks that are put up because there's a bridge out on the other side. When the Lord puts roadblocks up in your life and you seek to crash through them with a bridge out on the other side, it is going to lead to your own destruction. For some, they are heaping up damnation, heaping up wrath for a day of wrath, because they have plugged their ears and hardened their hearts and turned their minds away from God and His Word and all of the blessings that He brings with it. This is a sober warning. It's heavy. But my friends, as I've sought to show, it is laced with mercy. It is laced with mercy. The Lord Jesus Christ is meek and lowly. But the Lord Jesus Christ is more concerned about His own glory than anything else on the planet. And He'll bring whatever has to happen to preserve that. It was the Lord Jesus Christ on two occasions that took and made a whip of cords and overthrew money changers and flogged them and chased them out of the house because they were corrupting the worship of God. That's the Christ with whom we have to do. He's the one described as seated in the glory of heaven upon an invincible throne with a sword that proceeds from His mouth, with which He slays the nations, whose garments are dipped in blood. We see, thirdly here, reconsidering God's word. The prophet had brought the word of the Lord and had delivered it to Jeroboam. He had confronted his idolatries. And the Lord continues to do that with us again and again and again and again and again, day after day, Sabbath to Sabbath to Sabbath. Christ comes into our midst, and He's dealing faithfully with us, dealing lovingly with us, dealing mercifully with us, and no more so than when He breaks into our world and disrupts our idolatrous hearts. The problem with idols is if you make them, He will break them. It is guaranteed. The Lord will not suffer to share His glory with any. If you make them, He will, and always does, break them, because false gods always fail. Jeroboam has come to see that. Sadly, in his case, he hardens his heart under it and goes back to his idols. And he ends up being, as we've already noted in a previous sermon, he ends up being the capstone testimony, example for the rest of Old Testament history of what it means to be an ungodly king, to walk in the ways of Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, to cause Israel to sin. But the Lord has given to us another way, hasn't He? He's given us another king who, like David, had a heart for the Lord, only far more so, the son of David, he who is the branch, Christ Himself, the King of all kings. And the Lord Jesus Christ is the one who, for His own glory, comes and stoops into all of the lowliness of His sacrifice and service in order to redeem a people from our idols. And He is broken in order that His people might be redeemed, healed, forgiven. The Lord came in order that He might save us from our native heart idolatries and to secure for us a word from heaven that would indeed save us not only temporally, but eternally, with life that is forevermore. This is our Redeemer, and he has the power to save. And as we heard this morning, he alone has divine glory. Nothing and no one shares that with God himself. And Christ, as the Son of God, the second person of the Trinity, has all of that divine glory, the most exquisite, irresistible object of beauty and delight. And Christ says, I am yours and you are mine. To the Christian, you no longer have to be frittering away your life with empty, dumb, blind idols. The Lord gives us himself and enables us to have him, and in having him, to have all things. Let's stand together for prayer. O Lord our God, we pray that you would be our God, that we would be able to say that we are crying out to Jehovah our God, and that we, O Lord, would have our hearts captivated and subdued in obedience and allegiance and love to you alone. O Lord, it is true, our hearts are a perpetual factory of idols, and we find our only hope in your gospel grace to deliver us from such foolishness and to give us in place yourself. O Lord, grant unto us that we might cling to you, heed your word, that we might rejoice in the mercy of you disrupting our comforts and crashing and bashing our idols in order to train us to cling to yourself. O Lord, continue that good work, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's sing together from Psalm 109, verses 28 to 31. Psalm 109, verses 28 to 31. The tune is Eriksteen, which is tune number 58. Psalm 109, although they curse with spite, yet, Lord, bless thou with loving voice. Let them ashamed be when they rise, thy servant let rejoice. Let thou mine adversaries all with shame be clothed over, and let their own confusion them as a mantle cover. Verses 28 to 31.
Thank you.
stand for the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and grant you peace.